My coverage of CES 2025 is brought to you by Gigabyte, Lexar, MSI, and Thermaltake. Hey guys, I'm over at ASUS, and it's really crowded here. There's lots of people. They have a handful of stuff that I specifically hand-selected that I thought you might be interested in. Yes, we are going to show you guys the RTX 50 series graphics cards, but I'm going to make you wait a little bit or maybe use the timestamps to jump ahead if that's what you're interested in. Let's start out with this motherboard over here. For AMD overclocking, we now have, at long last, the ASUS ROG Crosshair X870E Apex. The Apex motherboard lineup from ASUS for a very long time has been specifically focused on memory overclocking. So there's going to be a handful of people at least who are really interested in this board. Buildzoid, I think, in particular. I think he's already requested one. Of course, he uses the AM5 socket, so Ryzen 7000, 9000 processors. And I can't explain like all of the ROG overclocking technology that they're building into this board. But for those who are like interested in the aesthetics, Crosshairs often have a little PCB cutout. This one does too. And look, they've even put a little RGB bling right there. The overclocking technologies this board is capable of include Dynamic OC Switcher, Core Flex, Asynchronous Clock, and PBO Enhancement. And even just for ease of use, we have a new version of the Q release, or the Q connector, for the M.2. Look, you just push on that, and it pops right out. This also gives you access to this little catch point, so you can install your M.2 drives completely toollessly, which I totally appreciate. Also just below that is a new PCIe slot, and it's really hard to tell exactly what's going on here, but basically this is spring-loaded. So the latch here is spring-loaded. If you have a GPU installed, all you have to do is grab the GPU after you've released the screws on the side and sort of yank it. That will push back on this and automatically release the catch. So we've advanced and upgraded from having like a little button over here you push to release it, which was one of my favorite new motherboard features in quite some time. So now this latch will just unlatch itself. That's pretty cool. Here's the latest entry in the BTF, or back to front, or back to the future lineup, and they've now gone high-end. The ROG Maximus Z890 Hero BTF, so this is a Intel motherboard for their new Core Ultra series of processors. Never mind that though, let's focus on the board itself. Since it's a BTF board, it is a hefty one because they have lots of covered panels to help protect certain areas where they have moved the connectors to the back of the board for like CPU power up there, fan headers, and so on and so forth. I've been pretty vocal about the BTF theme that's been going for a couple years now and the practicality of it. I will say, when you're building a system, the ease of connecting some of the connectors, and particularly these supplemental CPU power connectors up there, is improved by a BTF design. The flip side is that you're now limited in what cases you can choose to actually install it with. If you want to plug in the connectors on the back, you need a case that's compatible. But ASUS has been working with more case manufacturers, such as Fractal. Here is that motherboard installed. This is an ASUS design case, which is called the A31 ATX BTF. Just showcasing how clean the build is, and I will say that, you know, if that's what you're going for, they definitely achieve that. It's even further enhanced by the fact that there is not a graphics card installed, although this does have the connector right here. It's compatible with the ASUS BTF graphics cards that you plug in here, and then it delivers up to 600 watts of power through that connector. And hey, while we're at it, here's the newest version of the Ryujin cooler. This is the Ryujin 4, and it's even blingier and cooler than the previous versions. New design on the fans up here, and these are daisy chainable, so they can link together without having to handle a bunch of different cables. And they have I believe this is a 6 or 7 inch AMOLED screen with a wraparound display. This little panel here has stats that rival like some gaming monitors. It's 2560 by 1440, 60 hertz refresh rate, which, like, do you need that in your system? Personally, I don't really. It's more of an aesthetic upgrade for me, but a lot of people really like having as much bling in their system as possible with RGB, LED panels, and so on. So even more options for that with the Ryujin 4. We have the traditional wall of motherboards up here, which I'm not gonna focus on too much, but we do have two new chipsets available. For Intel, we have the B860 chipset, so we're gonna have more reasonably priced boards for that. 4-core Ultra, so that should hopefully align with some of the lower-end CPUs that they are also launching this week. We also have an all-white version, that's the B860-A gaming Wi-Fi right here. Here's a nice clean-looking micro ATX all-white board. This is the B860-G gaming Wi-Fi. Very nice-looking board with the all-white aesthetic, and I appreciate that ASUS has given some love to the micro ATX form factor because that is popular. It is sort of in the middle between SFF and full size, and it gives you a bit more expandability. But if you do want really small, here's the B860-I gaming Wi-Fi. If you're more interested in AMD, I don't blame you. But here's the B850 chipset boards from ASUS. This is the ROG Strix B850-E gaming Wi-Fi. Next is the ROG Strix B850-F gaming Wi-Fi right here. And I'm not running down all the features of these because I do not have the time, but I'm just giving you guys a quick look at the aesthetics. Another very clean looking all white board in the ROG Strix B850-A gaming Wi-Fi. And rounding things out, we have a mini ITX version, which I'm happy about because, you know, X870 doesn't really make that much sense for a mini ITX board. So here's the ROG Strix B850-I gaming Wi-Fi. Did they give it three M.2 slots? No, it's only got two M.2 slots. That's okay. As promised, here's a look at the BTF build that they have. This one's using a different motherboard, the Tough Gaming B850 BTF. So as you can see, no cables visible, very clean build inside. And the case is not an ASUS case, this is a Fractal. The Fractal North XL RC Charcoal Black, who ASUS has been working with to expand the number of cases on the market that are compatible with BTF. And if there's one thing I've said about BTF, or having the motherboards on the reverse side, that I think needs to be become a standard so that it's more widely compatible with a variety of cases, it's standardizing where the pass-throughs are on the motherboard so that we can have more case manufacturers jump in and make compatible cases. So I appreciate this. And again, even though I've been critical of BTF, I'm glad that they are going in this direction. Graphics cards. Look, there's the Founders Edition. Let's look at ASUS versions of the various RTX 50 series cards that have just recently been announced. And let's start with the big boy, which is this one right here. This is the ROG Astral. Do you hear that thud when it dropped down? So Astral is a new line, which I am told is going to have basically all of the same bling and build quality of the Strix lineup, but it's going to be like even better. And this card has gotten some press because it has not one, but four cooling fans. They basically went with a push-pull radiator configuration for this top portion of the card, having an additional fan there. How much will this improve the cooling on this card? We're not sure yet. We can't tell you. Definitely very, very curious to see what sort of a delta there is between cards like this and the Founders Edition, which is a two-slot card and just so much smaller. I don't know how much this weighs. Here's Paul's head size comparison. It's very big. It's a very large card. Let me get the front side so you can see all the fans. I don't know. Is that too big? Can a GPU be too big? Does it matter if it means that you can overclock it more and it runs at a cooler temperature? This is going to be like notorious for yanking PCI slots out of motherboards. And yeah, but it does have other features besides just being very huge and having four fans. They're also using thermal pads rather than thermal paste for cooling. They're using a vapor chamber and engineered fin spacing to maximize the amount of cooling that can pass through those fins, which is also supplemented by a vapor chamber, which you can't really see, but trust me, it's there. Also continuing useful ASUS features like having these pinouts on the motherboard so you can directly connect other fans, like your CPU fans, for example. If you have a graphics card like this, you might be more concerned with your GPU temperature than CPU temps. This will allow you to connect additional fans that can be directly controlled by the graphics card. And of course, yes, there's also a VBIOS switch. Oof, chunk. Here's another Astral card from that lineup. This is the LC, which stands for liquid cooled. And this one, thankfully, is a bit smaller. It's still maintaining two slot spacing, although it is a bit taller since it does have the integrated, I believe the pump's integrated over here. It's got a pump in that loop somewhere. But also, as we've seen with some of the other RTX 5090s and even 5080s, they're pairing this with a 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler, triple 120 fans. Moving down the line with some cards designed for mortals, people who are not omnipotent and omnipowerful and who do not have unlimited bank accounts. This is a 5070 Ti. Still an expensive card. Base price is going to be $750 for this. And I have a sneaking suspicion that some of ASUS's versions of the cards are going to cost more than that. But they're continuing the use of phase change thermal pads, even down this lineup with the ROG Strix versions of the card. But of course, a lot of people are interested in the aesthetics, so just trying to give you guys a close-up look at this GPU. It's very clean. I like the design. I like the bit of texture that you have on the back plates, and of course, pass-through right there for the three blower fans on this side. Moving down the line, we have the Tough series. So this one's going to be a step, should be a step down in pricing compared to the Strix card. Tough gaming lineup with a bit more of an industrial aesthetic, some dark gray, some brushed metal, some silver accents throughout as well. And we also have some RGB in the Tough logo there. Also happy to say that we still have a dual VBIOS switch on this card, which is a nice feature. And there's a quick look at the backplate. And then we have the Prime card. The ASUS Prime cards are supposed to be SFF ready. And I believe this card counts. Is it? Is this more than two slots? Anyway, it says it's SFF ready. So I'm going to trust the cheat sheet there that this is SFF ready. But as part of the Prime series, this card should be among the more affordable options for a 5070 or a 5070 Ti from the ASUS lineup. And I appreciate that they've gone with an all-new design here. Got the Prime right there alongside the GeForce RTX. There's a quick look at the backplate for you there, some black brushed metal on the back. And again, still maintaining dual mode for a VBIOS switch, which is one of the features that I think if you're going to spend a little bit more on a graphics card, I mean, you can spend more because they're overbuilt or because they're factory overclocked. All that stuff I don't think provides a lot of extra value because overclocking a GPU is not that tough these days. But a dual VBIOS switch, that is useful. Of course, there's laptops now that will have the mobile RTX 50 series GPUs. I'm going to be focusing on the desktop side of things, so not taking too long of a look at that. But look at this right here. I'm going to end on this. This is the ROG NUC 2025 edition. Super tiny little chassis. Some of the nice features of this is that it has DDR5 memory that is actually slotted. Like, you can remove the memory and upgrade it if you want. It also has dual M.2 SSD slots, which is cool. And they're fitting up to an RTX 5080 in this tiny little box. I mean, look how thin it is. That's quite thin. So very thin, tiny little PC in the ROG NUC 2025 edition. Of course, this will be available in a variety of different configurations, but I know there's gonna be at least a few people who are like, I don't wanna build a computer this time around. I'm gonna get something tiny like this, and the fact that they're able to wedge up to a 5080 in this is pretty impressive to me. They have lots more stuff on display here, but I am out of time, so that's gonna wrap it up for my coverage of ASUS here at CES 2025. I wanna say a huge thank you to my sponsors for this event, Thermaltik, MSI, Gigabyte, and Lexar. I have more videos coming at you real soon. Thumbs up button. The link to the playlist is down in the description. We'll see you in the next one.